What's up, YouTube, man? This is Team THB. I'm your host today. I got the whole THB squad with me right now, and we finna sit here and talk about some 2K17. And a lot of people has been doing a whole bunch of conversations on 2K's the new blacktop mode and the My Team and Pro-Am. But you guys know that we're going to destroy everybody when it comes to running My Park. So we're going to sit here and kind of talk about what we expect from our players, what players we're going to create, what badges we feel we should get. There's a whole new badge system when it comes to having gold badges, having bronze, having silver, and having a Hall of Fame. So I think I'm going to pick somebody to do this. You know what I'm saying? Let's start off with Swag Tavius himself. Let's start off with Swag Tavius. So, Moni, what kind of player are you going to make this year?
I'm going to make a shooting guard slasher.
Okay.
Why is shooting guard this year?
I don't want to play point this year. Y'all two are going to be point, so I want to be something different from point guard position so that when we play people on threes, I can be the taller player.
Okay.
Considering the fact that y'all both are going to be guards. So, and plus, being a slasher, I like to go to the basket. I want to have a bigger body player to be able to do that with so I can still catch my contact dunks.
Okay.
Be able to get those physical layups at the basket, be able to play physical on defense, you know, play to my true play style. I'm not really a good shooter in 2K, so, you know, I'm just going to create a player that's kind of tailored to how I play the game.
Okay, so
switch position, play a shooting guard slasher.
Okay, so within that, which badge do you feel that you want a Hall of Fame? Out of Relentless Finisher, Posterizer, Lob City Finisher, Teardropper, and One Man Fast Break?
I mean, just the Relentless Finisher and Posterizer are the ones you want to Hall of Fame. It's like those badges are the ones that's usually the most powerful badges in 2K. I mean, you have either one of those or both of them combined. And your player will feast. I mean, Teardropper, I don't know how effective it's going to be because it was broken 16.
Yeah, it was pretty
broke. And One Man Fast Break was OP, but they tweaked it. It would be in 2K17. But Posterizer and Relentless Finish have been pretty consistent.
So how tall do you plan on being this year?
6'5", 6'6".
And what about your weight?
Probably stay within like 200 pounds, maybe like 212,
okay.
Somewhere around there. I mean, because I think if a bigger body, but I don't want to be too slow, but I still want to have like some
so
speed.
What should people expect from you coming this year on in the blacktop? I mean, I'm sorry, not blacktop, but in My Park?
Just being a better overall team player. I mean, doing what I got to do. As far as being quick about my moves, getting to the basket, being a better passer, defender. I mean, doing pretty much all I did in 2K16, just even better.
Okay.
And it's really nothing to it. You just get out there and you just play.
All right, well, let's swing this thing.
So, you know, do whatever it takes to help us
all
out.
All right, let's swing this thing all over to T-Wall the Savage. If y'all don't know who T-Wall the Savage is, T-Wall the Savage is, I would consider T-Wall the Savage like the Rick Fox or like the Dennis Rodman of our team, because whenever I would consider them dirty points where it's just like we just need somebody to score, we need somebody to out hustle everybody, we just need like a somebody create a fucking play real quick. T-Wall normally is the one that we go to for that type of play. So Tyler, what kind of player can we look forward to you creating in 2K17?
I like that you feel that way about me, Trey. But you know what I'm saying. I want to make a 6'1" sharpshooter, a point guard on 2K17, because I want to be able to shoot threes.
Okay.
I'm not really worried about catching bodies this year. I just want to shoot.
So we can't expect that 6'10" T-Rod the Savage 2K16 player this year.
That player might come along like later on in 2K, but not right, not in the early stages of 2K.
Okay. So,
later on in 2K, I might make a shooting guard for the same reasons why Moni said he's making a shooting guard, because I want my player to be a little bit more durable and I heard that stuff on 2K, like Like if your player take too many shots, like he'll start to lose his energy, and by making a shooting guard, that won't happen as much as if he's a point guard.
Okay, so let me ask you this: out of the five badges, which badge do you feel that you go to Hall of Fame? Out of deep range, which is dead eye, limitless range, catch and shoot, corner specialist, or mid range dead eye.
Catch and shoot.
And why Hall of Fame catch and shoot?
Because I feel that like I could be open at times, and on 2K16, and I can't make a shot for to save my life, and I want to be able to just catch the ball and shoot. Okay. On 2K17.
All right, so let me ask you this. So this year coming up, are we only going to be expecting T-Raw to just be a three-point shooter, or can we expect anything else from T-Raw the Savage this year?
I don't know. We got to wait to see what 2K17 going to bring. But I hope to be a better team player. Hope to pass the ball more.
Okay. All right, so let's swing things over to.
I'm trying to beat. I'm gonna take over the assist. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, we're not going that far. You gonna sit your big ass down?
Oh shit!
You better watch yourself before you make yourself your real counterpart, nigga. You know what I'm saying? You better calm your ass down.
Hey,
you better calm your ass down.
By the first couple months of 2K, I ain't gonna have no A button no more.
You better calm down, bro. You know what I'm saying? Before you put your ass on the bench. All right, you guys, so let's switch over things to Uzi. Uzi, a.k.a. Darius. If you guys haven't seen Darius, if Tyler is Dennis Rodman of our team, then I would have to say Darius is probably Scottie Pippen, because I don't know. Like, Darius takes – first of all, Darius takes unnecessary shots. Let's first of all put that out there. He always looks the dumbest out of all of us. Like, the whole headband with the dreads.
Then he should be Dennis.
No. We're talking about just looks, not play style. We're talking about looks. You know what I'm saying? Sit down, my nigga. You know what I'm saying? Nah, but one thing I do love about playing with Darius is that Darius is not afraid.
I'm Darius,
no, calm down. You know what I'm saying? Calm down. You know what I'm saying? One thing I love about...
Trey is Terry Crews.
All right, yo, Tyler, you gonna be 5'8", 320 pounds. Yo, Eddie, look. One thing I do love about Darius is that when you play with Darius, you got somebody who's not afraid to play. First of all, like great defense on both ends. You know what I'm saying? He can play full court, and he can play inside, and he can play perimeter. So you got somebody that can play good defense all the way around. Depending on his players, it's always like a different style from Darius. If he has a small player, which we call him Little Deuce Deuce, you're gonna get like a lot of ball handling, a lot of ankle breakers, and a lot of threes. When he picks a 6'4", you get a lot of like going to the basket, some good moves, just a quick crossover, get to the basket, and just dunk. Like, and it's a lot of highlights. So. Darius, what player are we expecting from you this year after having Deuce Deuce and Big Uzi? What are we getting from you this year, man?
But you know, this year, you know, we're gonna go ahead and get the small forward main all player.
Right. All right, how about us? What's gonna be?
A bit of point forward.
Okay, so you picking point forward. This is actually kind of catching me off guard. All right, you picking point forward is weird to me. So, why are you picking point forward this year?
Why are you picking 24? You see, my 3 is going to be a 15. So, and my badges, look, let me read you my badges. Got Dimer, Ankle Breaker, Pick and Roll Maestro, Flashy Passer, and Lob City Passer. You know what I'm saying? My layup and dunk is going to be a 16, so I can still catch bodies and stuff. You know,
all right, so let me say this. With that being said, even though this is kind of a surprise to me, because like I was assuming that either Darius is going to pick shot creator. You know, I think he's trolling right now. I'm going to be honest. I think Darius is trolling right now, because Darius is not the pass type person. If you guys go and watch some of our older streams, or even our older game, our old gameplays, if Darius is in it, they ain't no passing from this motherfucker. He's not passing us the ball. You know what I'm saying? So I'm surprised that he's even talking about being a point forward. So I'm expecting him to pick Shock Raider. So when the game comes out, I'm telling y'all, I'm expecting him to pick Shock Raider. So we gonna let him keep trolling right now. So there's within these badges, the five badges, which badge are you going to Hall of Fame?
Ankle breaker.
Okay, see, now I really know he's trolling. This is how I really know Darius is trolling right now. This is how I know he's trolling. There's no way he's going to pick ankle breaker as his badge. There's no way Darius is going to pick ankle breaker as his badge. Because first of all, Darius doesn't even stand, hold the ball.
Bro, I'm not trolling.
Bro, I feel like you're trolling right now. Like, I'm not even going to give you too much attention right now because I think you're trolling. I'm expecting Darius to pick Shot Creator. I'm just letting y'all know. I'm expecting Darius to pick Shot Creator this year.
Probably from a point guard.
All right. So, what can we expect from you this year, Uzi, coming into 2K17 on my part?
That nigga look like Trey.
Highlights, on top of highlights, and a lot of you can't hold me.
Can you speak English? Can you speak English for the people that don't know our lingo?
All right, look. Make my player like Kevin Durant.
So why would you make a point forward if you're making a Kevin Durant? That's a shot creator.
No. The 3 too low for a shot creator.
What do you mean the 3 is too low for the shot creator? How is that?
It's a 13.
It's a 13. It's 2 clicks below 15.
The point forward is a 16.
No, the point forward is hold on. I think it's 15. No, it's 15.
Oh no, it is.
It's 15. So it's 2 clicks above. That, is that really going to make a huge difference? I mean, remember. Yeah, but look, know. Remember this. You don't have a shooting badge. There are no shooting badges. So you make a point forward and you have no shooting badges. You feel what I'm saying? Like, so I mean, it's not like you're gonna get the greatest shooter in the world. He's a point forward, but he's only gonna have a 15, and then you have no shooting badges at all. So nothing to enhance to your jump shot. Like, it's kind of like you're kind of putting yourself out there. Yeah, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I might make a shot.
See what I? Y'all see what I mean? This is what I mean by I knew this nigga was trolling.
You're right. I'll make a shot.
That's what I'm talking about, man. Now let's re-ask that question. What can we expect from Uzi this year on 2K17 without the trolling?
I'm gonna expect a lot of you're gonna catch a lot of highlights, like I said, man.
You know what?
I'm gonna be a little spot up shooter. No, I ain't gonna handle the ball too much like I did last year because I'm not a point guard. You know what I'm saying?
All right. See, in it.
And
that's one thing I'm happy to hear is that we're gonna have a little bit more variety. Not all of us being point guards. That to me is a plus for us. All of us cannot be point guards. That hurt us last year. All of us being point guards. But when Tyler created his 6'9" player or 6'10", you know, and then you created a 6'4". Justin created a 6'3". You know, it added more variety for us to play against other players that had centers and you know, the small forward. The cheese came after patch six. But all right. So this question is directed towards me. So now, for me coming into 2K17, which 2K16 was my first time actually playing 2K, or not 2K in general, but playing my part is actually my first time. So I plan on creating a playmaker. A lot of people are going to make playmaker because they want to have ankle breaker and all that other good stuff, but I'm making mine's primary focused on being a facilitator, being the floor general, just like I was in 2K16, really making sure that I get Moni, Justin, Tyler, and Darius involved with having the ball and giving them more easier shots than what I did last year. I didn't have a great handle, especially when I first started. I didn't know what speed booster was, so now that there is no speed booster, but I've gotten a lot better with the dribble stick. With this year coming up, knowing I can do more, I can be way, way, way more creative and finding ways to help, you know, all my teammates get open, getting them easier shots, getting them more opportunities to create highlights like alley-oops. I really want to expose this double alley-oop feature. Like, I really want to get a double alley-oop from Justin and Darius or from Tyler and Moni. You know what I'm saying? Like, I really want to get this double alley-oop going and be the first person that threw it. So it's like, okay, here it comes. I know a double alley-oop's coming because I'm killing my opponent. I'm not really sure what to expect. I was talking to Justin about this earlier. I told him that I'm definitely going to Hall of Fame the flashy passer badge. Now, Justin asked me why was I going to Hall of Fame that badge. So go ahead, Jay, ask me that question again.
Well, Trey, I mean, you do seem like you make a valid point with making a playmaker, but why would you max out? I mean, why would you Hall of Fame your flashy passer instead of diamond?
I'm glad you asked, Jay. Glad you asked. I feel like the flashy passer badge is more important than Dimer. Reason being is because whatever player you're pretending yourself to be, Moni's pretending himself to be an inside scorer. So if Moni's going to be an inside scorer, why do I need to Hall of Fame a Dimer badge, which is only for the percentage of the shot to go in, if all I'm going to be doing is throwing dimes? I want to enhance the dime I'm throwing to get the pass there in the first place. If I only have a gold dimer in a Hall of Fame dimer and a gold flashy passer, say there's somebody that's good at stealing the ball. If it's only at gold, that means that it's still one step away from being unstoppable. So that means that there are going to be people that are going to steal my passes. So yes, you have Hall of Fame dimer, but say a dude can't shoot. Like if Tyler makes a player that's not heavy on shooting. If Tyler doesn't make a sharpshooter and Tyler makes a lockdown defender, if I throw a dime to him and I have a Hall of Fame dimer, does it matter? He can't shoot. But if I have flashy passer and he's a lockdown defender and he's in the key, I can throw a good-ass pass and get that pass through like two defenders. You know what I'm saying? And then Tyler's wide open for an easy layup. Or Moni's open for an easy layup. So I feel like the Hall of Fame badge for flashy passer is more important than having it for dimer. Because if Darius makes shot creator and he can shoot in front of people, then that means that he's Hall of Fame at shooting difficulty shots. That's his enhancement right there. Why does he need my dimer for more enhancement? He's already a Hall of Fame difficulty shot shooter. So he doesn't need my dimer to help him shoot. So that's kind of a waste. If it's gold, it's already gold. If your player can shoot, he can shoot. If he can't shoot, my Hall of Fame dimer is not going to help that. So like I said, for me, expect to see a whole bunch of flashy passes. Expect to see some of the best passes in 2K. Expect to see me breaking down defenses with using my teammates to their best abilities and understanding them more than anything. Me trying to help them get their highlights. That's really what I want to do, is help them get their highlights and help them expose every single person that we go up against by using myself as the floor general or as the person that brings out other defenders to me and giving them the one-on-ones that they need. So with that being said, let's skip over to this.
How tall do you plan on making yourself?
I plan on being my real life counterpart, which is 6'2". And my weight, I'm going to go between 180 and 190. I might make 190, just because I don't want to be, you know, too small, but I do want to be a strong player. So, I'm going to skip over a little bit right now. Let's step over to the jump shot maker. I want to know, first off, I'm gonna start off with Darius this time. If creating a new jump shot, what jump shot are you going to try to craft? Like, what two jump shots do you feel you're going to put together?
Let's see, probably a Westbrook base, as you jump high, and a 58 release.
Okay, say there is no 58 numbers. Because one thing I was telling Justin is don't base off that. Let's pick two NBA players. I was telling Justin the same thing. Okay. Let's not think about 2K16. Let's only think about solely on 2K17.
Yeah, I make a Westbrook base and Damian Lillard.
Okay. All right, Tyler.
I think I will go with I think I would go with probably like something like with a high arc, like LeBron or something, or you know what? I think I would go with Curry, form, right.
Man, Tyler, you are taking 8 hours and 19 years, bro.
Curry form with Carmelo's base.
So you want a fast release, but you don't want your player to jump. Like you don't want like a high jump. You just kind of want like a faster release. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I can kind of see that jump shot. Yeah, I can kind of see that jump shot because Carmelo Anthony doesn't jump too high. So you know. All right. Moni, holla at me. What shot we looking
but
at?
But wait. You know.
Oh shit.
On 2K17, they have a very fast. And a very slow release too.
Yeah, I mean, I get that, but some jump shots are naturally just gonna, you know, have a slower release. Even if it's very fast, some jump shots are just gonna be slow. Like, I don't see Dirk Nowitzki on very fast. I mean, that's gonna look pretty stupid. Dirk Nowitzki on very fast. You know what I'm saying? Like, could you imagine somebody mixes Dirk Nowitzki with LeBron James jump shot? I mean, damn. Like, that's a pretty slow jump shot right there. So. Moni, let's go over there and step over to you, man. What are we looking at?
I don't even know why you're even asking me. Y'all know I don't shoot. So 9 shots out of 10, I'm going to probably keep it real basic. Probably mix two players who don't really shoot three-pointers like Jordan and Kobe. Okay. So I'll probably have Jordan's base and Kobe's release. I mean, I'm not a shooter. So I don't really tend on tripping off of the shooting part itself. So I'm probably just going to find something really simple to use. Just something that, you know, can let me get the shot off. But anything that's good like mid-range. So I'll probably just pick like Jordan and Kobe.
Okay.
Jordan and Kobe, and probably Jordan's base and Kobe's release, or Kobe's base and Jordan's release, since I'm familiar with Jordan's release in 2K16, and it was the only one that really worked for me. And since they're both shooting guards, I'm assuming that may play a factor in it. So that's where I'm going with that. Or maybe even Jordan's base and D-Wade's release. You know, just something, you know, that's kind of pertaining to guards, that's more tailored to guards and more tailored to how I shoot, because it's like, y'all know I don't shoot really that good. Right. I mean, I'm hit or miss when it comes to shooting.
Okay.
So I'm definitely going to try to keep it, you know, as simple as possible, or try to make it easy for myself to try to get the green lights and the good looks and all.
Okay,
that.
Jay, talk to me. What are we looking at?
I would say either Kyrie's base with Steph's release or vice versa, or just Steph's base and his release.
Okay.
Because I do believe that they're going to fix Steph's jump shot in 2K17, because in 2K16, it being on quick was very slow, so I know they're probably going to fix that. So that's what I'm going to go with.
All right. I like that. I mean, it's not what I was expecting from you, but actually, I can see you picking those two just because, especially because you're going to pick Shot Creator. So, you know, I could definitely see. Oh, my bad. Hold on. I skipped Justin. Yeah, hold on. You're not slick, little nigga. Jay, what player are we going to expect from you this year, little nigga?
I would have to say a 7-2 glass cleaner, because
Justin,
you know,
stop. Don't do that shit. We're not doing that. We're not doing that shit. Don't do that shit.
Well, you know, THB doesn't have a center, so you know, it would be a great idea, you know, just to, you know, take the backseat role and, you know, be the snagger.
Justin, I'll beat your ass
needs,
with a coke and
know.
A smile. Don't do that. Don't do that. Don't do that, bro. Come on, man. Be serious.
Honestly, I would say that I'm gonna make a Shot Creator point guard.
Okay.
Because although his three isn't as high as I'd like it to be, I don't really take a lot of set shots. I'm more of a off dribble shooter, and I can create a lot of shots for myself in 2K and in real life. So why not just make myself my real counterpart in 2K?
All right. So since we already know what the badges are, Jay, so which badge do you see yourself golding out? But I'll reread them again. So it'll be Difficult Shots, Teardropper, Tireless Shooter, Ankle Breaker, and Mid-Range Deadeye.
I would have to say that I would probably Hall of Fame Difficult Shooter.
Okay. And why not Ankle Breaker? Even though, even though, you know, I see why you would do Difficult Shot, but why not Ankle Breaker?
Because the five badges that they do give you, you can make them gold. So if you can catch ankles already just with gold badges, then I feel that it's not really necessary to Hall of Fame my ankle breaking badge. Plus, I shoot a lot of contested shots, and I shoot a lot of different shots. So I would feel that it would be best to Hall of Fame my difficult shots instead of ankle breaker.
Okay. I like that. So what can we expect from you this year coming on my part?
That I'm going to be a score first point guard, but I'm not going to be selfish, but I am going to be a threat on all cylinders, and that a lot of highlights will be made, and Chef J is going to do what he does best.
I like that. All right, so now we're going to touch on something a little. I feel like this is a game changer, especially it's going to determine who's novice and who's actually real Hall of Famers in NBA 2K17. They have a new layup feature. We know about the new shot feature. That's cool. But they have a new layup feature. Are you going to still use the square button, or are you actually going to learn how to do the whole layup meter? Like, were you going to learn how to green light layups to where you can score in traffic, or are you just going to use the square button and say, F it, I'll just let the layup go in. If it goes in, it does. If it doesn't, it doesn't.
I would say that I'm going to use square still.
Okay. Moni?
I wasn't using square to do my layups. I was using the stick. So I'll test out the layup stick to just see what it does.
Okay. Tyler?
I mean, if you have control to green light, why not?
Tyler?
Yeah, I'm going to test the stick too. I'm going to test the stick out for the shot too.
Okay. Darius?
I'm sticking with the square. Shoot with it. Lay up with it, dunk with it.
Okay, so for Justin, what is it about the stick that kind of makes you not want to use it? What is it about knowing that you have to time the layup makes you not want to use it?
The fact that I'm not very comfortable with it, because I've been using square pretty much all of 2K, so doing something new is going to feel very unorthodox. And being a shot creator, you have to be very efficient at your job, and I don't really have, or I feel that I don't really have time to try to learn a whole new system when it comes to scoring, because I need to be an instant offense player.
But don't you feel that if you're using the stick, especially because you're a shot creator and you have the ability to go inside and you have the ability to go outside, but the most important thing is you can shoot off the dribble. If you're a shot creator and you can go to the basket and score a layup on two people by using the stick and just practicing green lighting, don't you feel like that's more important than just oh, I'm uncomfortable with it, I'm not going to use it?
Well, I'm sure the system is going to be different, and it's going to be square and the stick. You're going to have to green light both of them.
Yeah, but you.
So either way, I'm going to have to get used to it.
The hardest thing is you being able to control which hand you're using. I mean, obviously in 2K, it is important to use the right hand at the right time. You using your left hand on the right side of the basket, but a dude is trying to chase down block you, makes a huge difference than you using your right hand and leaving your right hand open for that chase down block. You know what I'm saying? So, I mean, I feel like, I feel like for shot creators and people that are being sharpshooters, it's going to be hell of important to green light layups, just because you're not perfect at going at layups, and using the square button to just let the layup just go in, I feel like that will be the downfall to those type of players, especially if you're not like Moni, who's going to create a inside player who's going to be able to score inside anyway. So if he doesn't green light layups, it doesn't really matter. He'll make them anyways.
Well, I mean, that is true, but also on the flip side of that, there are a lot of, like 80% of the 2K community, everybody plays overly aggressive. So as soon as you drive to the basket, everybody just runs and pushes Y or triangle. So if that's the case, then I can just always just hold L2 and go into a post animation and wait for them to jump past me or just stand there and then just and then make my lip even easier.
I can agree with that. I'm not gonna disagree with that. I mean that this one I feel like this feature will probably be one of those things that we're gonna have to sit in my career and just the whole doing work feature. And just practice the layup until we all get it down. And now, speaking of doing work, the new feature of doing work, do you guys like or dislike being able to sit in my career and just shoot and shoot and shoot until you start to get attribute upgrades? Or do you rather be like, oh, you should have to go to practice and play games to get attribute upgrades? I'll let Tyler take this one first. Moni, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I'll go first. I mean, you should be able to get attribute points by doing anything. It doesn't have to be like you just going straight into practice. It should be everything. If you're shooting in the gym, even if you by yourself in my court, it should be a bigger grind to get the attribute point. But you should be able to get. You should be able to get attribute points in everything you do, because I mean, in real life, if you practice, then practice makes perfect. So if you practicing your shots, you practicing this, you want to eventually get better. So if you're doing it, you know, in the gym, you're doing it, you know, during practice and all that, you should get an attributes, and that depends on how many shots you hit in a row. But it should be a high amount. Like you got to sit there, and you should only get one. For the time that you did it, not that you can spam it or farm it or anything.
Hey, Tyler, you're gonna have to turn your TV down.
Basically, you can get one. You can get one from, you know, doing it in my court and then in his court. One from each, and it's each thing that you do. So, like, if you're practicing like your layups, you'll get one for whatever you're scoring, the inside scoring or whatever. If you got one for shooting, you get one for shooting. But it's not that you can farm it or anything, but it's that. You can get an attribute, and it's just one time that you can get it, you know, pretty much. Not that you can do it every single time, but you can get one from doing it so that it happens. And even in my park, while you're playing in the game, you should be able to get attribute points. And I think that's where you should be able to get them the most is when you're playing my park, since it's the most, it's the heaviest part of the game that you'll be playing. So I think you should be able to get attribute points while you're in my park instead of having to go through my career to do it, because you get a lot of guys who will come into my park with 75s or 55s or 65s because they just don't want to sit there and grind on my career, you know, to get all those attribute points, or they don't have the money to get an 88 player and then grind from there. But if players can actually get attribute points while they're playing in my park, that would make it more streamlined to, you know, play my park, where it's like, well, even though my player is bad, I can still get attribute points while I'm playing. So I think you should be able to get them in every aspect, practice, my park, my career, just about in every way, because this is like your player. Since this is a guy you're using all the time, it should be like everything is being tracked from whatever you do. So I feel you should get in every aspect. My career, my court, my part, gym, practice mode. Like, you should be able to do it just by every aspect of my career.
All right, so with that being said, are you guys excited the fact that this year you have to play a lot of my career and you won't be able to spend as much time in my park as you like to when you first get the game? Or are you like, oh, actually?
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely.
Okay, yep. Why?
Yep.
Because I like my career anyway, but it just, yeah, you won't have that much teasers at the park and shit. They got to be in my career grinding. You feel me? You can't just spam up all the dribbles and all the badges and stuff, because you already get your 5 set badges, so you can't make all them other badges go. So,
okay, let me say this. This is the reason why I asked that question is because I feel like, you know, when you play 2K16, you know, once all of us kind of watched the videos on YouTube and figured out how to hurry up and get our player good, we were able to create like 2-3 players and, you know what I'm saying, go to my park in about, I would say, about a good week, and, you know, our player was good enough to play in my park. But now in 2K17, we won't be able to create multiple characters. I feel like once you create that one character, you're stuck with that one character, because you, in order to get that player good, you're going to have to grind and play all of my career for a hot minute. You won't just be able to cheese left to right crossover to get ankle breaker or to get, you know, step back, you know, freeze or whatever. You're going to actually have to play each game and go to practice and doing work. So I don't like, I kind of told Justin earlier, like, you're going to have to pride yourself on your player. Because if you spend.
Can I say something? Oh, not to cut you off, but I also like the fact that you have to play my career, because it's also going to show who's actually good in 2K and who's not. Because 2K16 is very broken, and you can just spend $40 and make an 88 and literally do everything a 99 can do. But the fact that you have to play my career now, it's going to show who actually has skill in the game and who's not, and it's going to make you grind and to be good and make your player good.
And I agree. I 100% agree with that. My biggest question was... do you feel that buying VC is worth it this year? Yeah. I mean, because think about it.
To start you off, yes.
This is why I said that. When we played 2K16, it was easy to get your player good. But this time coming around, you're going to have to play my career anyways. So is it really worth buying VC this year? I mean, think about what I'm really saying. You can't max your player out. You probably won't even be able to get to an 88. So it's like... you're going to have to do the doing work. You're going to have to do all of that stuff. So is it really worth buying VC now? Like, is it worth it?
Yeah, because you're going to get your attributes from doing work. But if you don't have the VC to upgrade your attributes, then it kind of sucks.
That's kind of like my point. Like, okay, so say you have the VC, right? But you can't use the VC to max your player out till about, I would say, three or four days from now. So what's the point in buying the VC if I'm gonna play my career and earn the same amount of money I would have earned if I'd have bought the $10 worth of VC? Why would I buy the VC if I'm gonna have to play the games and earn the cash anyways?
It's because they're making you grind now. It's longer, and nobody wanna grind from a 55 because it's gonna be even longer.
Okay. I've always put it like, I've always thought about that too. You shouldn't start at a 55.
Exactly.
Well, it should let you do a series of, it should let you do like a series of drills or something, like a shooting drill, defensive drill, like stuff in the game that kind of lets your player, kind of gives you a scope of what your player is, or if you're playing through like the high school section, the college section, that whatever you did during those college games, like your, how good you shot, how good you passed, that affects your rating. You shouldn't start off at it. You're a first round draft pick, but you're 55 overall. It looks stupid. Now it looks a lot better when you're a first round draft pick and you're a 75 or you're 74 or you're a 77 or something. It makes more sense. It doesn't make sense for you to be a 55 overall and you're a first round player, because your player is expected to start, you know, at some point. He's supposed to get some minutes. So what are you supposed to do with a 55 overall player? It never made sense to me, and that's where the problem with the buying VC comes in, is that if you made a player 75, you really wouldn't need to buy VC, because you just sit there and grind for it, because eventually you get what you need.
Right.
So the fact that they kind of let you define the fact that you got to start 55 is like the gimmick of making you buy VC, because you don't want to start at 55. Stupid. I mean, there's some people who can't afford it. I don't like the fact that they make players like that, because for the people who can't afford it, you know, they have to grind. But for the people who can't, and I don't think that's fair. I think it's just, it should just be your player starts. What you do with your players determines your overall. But if you're like a first round, like if it says high first round, then it should give you like a overall range from 70 to 75 if you're a first round, or 77. If you're a second round, then you know it's going to be from like 65 to 69 or something. And if it's anything lower, then it would be make more sense if you're like a sixth round or something, or fourth round, whatever, and then your player is a 55. But if you did really good in the college and stuff, it should track your, it should, I just say the overall should be dynamic. It shouldn't be that everyone starts off at a 55 and you did all that work in college for, because you basically did all that for no reason.
Well, that's pretty much what it's equivalent to. I mean, it's kind of dumb that you go into the NBA as this superstar talent at overall 55.
Yeah, it doesn't match what they expected of you.
You're a superstar ass. I never understood that logic. You come in as a 55, but you're supposed to be this superstar that's going to take over the NBA, but you have no stats. Like, you know, they max your player out in high school and college. You get to see what your player is at his full potential, and then when you get to the NBA, they drop you all the way down to 55, which to me made no sense. But We're not gonna make this video long. Make sure you guys please show us some mad love and share this with the whole entire world, because Team THB is coming this year on 2K17, and expect another video from us on Friday or maybe Saturday. It should be Saturday. We should drop a video on Saturday because the prelude comes out. So we'll have even more information with you guys. So I'm your host, Trey, and all the rest of the THB fam is here. Jahez, go ahead and say something.
You know what I'm saying? Thank you guys all for tuning in watching. Hope you guys all enjoyed.
Y'all can't hold me.
Dr. J signing out.
Yo, man, y'all already know, man. Just support THB, man. We need that help. Tell family, friends, and loved ones about us, man. Oh, and keep God first, of course. Yeah.
Tyler?
No, I'm saying. See you guys. No, I'm playing.
Okay, skip this nigga. Uzi?
Nah,
hurry up, Tyler.
You know what I'm saying? Like, thank you for the love and support and everything. Thanks for watching, you know. Be tuned. You know what I'm saying? Y'all gonna see some filthy highlights.
All right, Darius.
And 2K ain't the only thing we play.
That's true. That is true. Darius, go ahead and sign us out, man.
It's your boy Uzi two times, you know, aka Darius. Thanks for messing with us, dog. THB, takeover. 2K17, you know. Coming soon.
All right, man. We're sending up out of this video. We'll see you guys next time. Bye.